Well, welcome everyone. Thanks for being with us today. I'm so happy to be with Vivek, Javi, and Jean-André for this conversation about consumer behavior trends. And it's something that, like all of you who are with us today, the NRF has been closely monitoring for the last almost year and a half now. And it's going to continue to be fascinating to explore how consumer behavior is changing and evolving and how various trends have accelerated over the course of the last year and a half as we come out of the pandemic and what will happen post-pandemic as we resume some of those new behaviors. So why don't I just get it kicked off with our panelists and just ask Vivek maybe to help us start and share your thoughts on what are some of the biggest changes that you're seeing to consumer behavior? You certainly felt it with the visibility of your brand, and both in terms of behavior, but also in terms of the product mix and what you expect is going to happen as we move throughout the next year.
Thank you, Matt, Jean-André, and Javier. Nice being on a panel with you. I think, you know, if I was to reflect on, and I'll reflect on what I call the behavior now. It's not post-pandemic, but you know where we are. I don't know how much of this is because of the pandemic and how much of this is because consumers, I think, in general are healthy. But we are seeing clearly a move towards quality of product, you know, more fresh, better wines, better cuts of meat and so on. We're seeing also a move towards omni-channel shopping behavior. I think people want the convenience of online, but still enjoy the experience of coming back to the store. And I think we're also seeing consumers spending money on things at home. In our particular case, it's things like flowers. You know, people are buying things to decorate the home. And so I suspect some of that nesting behavior is still sticking with consumers. So I'd go on quality, omni-channel experience, and just notion of nesting at home.
Jean-André, from your perspective, maybe you could share your thoughts. And, obviously, Vivek and any businesses in the U.S. were categorized a certain way. And so when closing orders came down, they felt that in one way. Other businesses felt those closing orders in different way, had different kinds of impact on the brands. Could you talk to us a little bit about what are you seeing, both in terms of way you engage, but also consumer behavior shifting?
Yeah, so for us, it was a different story because we had to close our stores for several months in 2020. But what we saw, which is not, you know, uncommon, is an explosion in e-commerce.com business. Now, you know, Sephora already was a powerhouse in .com. We did about close to 40% of our sales on e-commerce before the pandemic. So we had a very strong base, but the business literally exploded. I mean, last year we did in North America close to $3 billion in .com sales, which is just an enormous numbers. The big surprise to us at the start of the year is as our stores are reopening and becoming more and more traffic coming back in, .com has stayed extremely high. So we have a very good story now is that .com is strong, nearly as strong as last year, but our stores are picking up dramatically. So the last few weeks specifically, with a change in government rules and, you know, with the announcement by the CDC, we have seen a significant pickup in our stores. We actually had several weeks where our stores are performing at a higher level than 2019, but .com has remained very high. So the sum of the two is very, very, very positive. Now, that said, traffic remains a challenge. I mean, traffic is still below 2019, especially in urban environment, in traditional malls. In more suburban malls, we see traffic coming back closer to 2019. We have seen a significant increase in conversion and a significant increase in basket size.
Well, that is great news. And your comment that the basket size has increased, that people are out shopping, clearly, I think, reflects the strength and the health and the vibrance of the consumer. And in this market, at least, the extraordinary support that we put into the market to make sure the customers could continue to be engaged in taking care of their families and taking care of certainly supporting job creation and driving economic activity. So Javi, I guess one of the other things that changed pretty dramatically is we all had to do more at home. because we couldn't do some of the things that we were used to doing. And so we worked from home, and children went to school from home, and we did all kinds of entertaining and recreation at home to the extent we could, and we exercised at home. Everything was about the home. And so can you talk about what you saw as consumers were responding to the changes in the market and what was happening from a medical and a health perspective, and what that did to the way in which your business was experiencing engagement with customers throughout last year?
Absolutely. Thank you, Matt. It's great to share this great time with my colleagues here. Absolutely. What we have seen, it's mainly a new relation from consumers to their home and how we interact with our home. I was in a chat and someone said something like, what would I tell to my home if it was a friend, right? And I think we will all say very different things these days. But I think we have seen different phases during all the pandemic. I think we started, as you said, with a very functional, need-driven, where we were all working from home, homeschooling, and we needed to adapt from one day to another to a new situation, right? And the home was not adapted. That was probably the first phase. I think we saw also after, since we had some more time at home, some of the projects that were delayed started to happen, like painting or even rebuilding a whole kitchen, right? And I think we moved, and even myself, we moved into a more emotional need because we couldn't go out, we couldn't interact as we were used to. And I think even myself, I tried to become a chef for a period of time with very, very low success. Then I realized I probably go back to my everyday, right? But it was this emotional need of interacting with home in a different way. We moved to a sanctuary, actually, where we needed to make our place a place to enjoy and a place to really have memories. And that we also saw in the demands of our products. But I cannot agree more with my colleagues here that we saw for sure an increase in demand when it comes to e-commerce. First, because it was the only option for us for a period of time. Second, because, I mean, it just happened, right? That because of the situation, it was much more convenient. But said that, I think it is also, as soon as we open our stores, creating these experiences, creating these emotions, it was so rich to see that people want bricks and clicks, and that it's probably here to stay, despite of the growth we have seen in e-commerce, which for sure is here to stay as well.
No, that's great. Thank you. And I think you're right, that acceleration that pulled forward so many changed behaviors that many of us won't want to give up what we gained in terms of that convenience or that new learned behavior, and that will stay with us as we go forward. And I guess maybe Jean-André, I could go back to you and ask, so consumers are looking for different things now in the post-pandemic environment, and not just in terms of convenience and safety and health and cleanliness, but they seem to be looking to businesses of all kind, and especially retailers, because of the unique relationship that retailers have with their customers. They're looking for you for other kinds of leadership and other kinds of signals and values and behaviors. Could you talk a little bit more about that? You've led a lot of work in this area, making people feel welcome in your stores and in your brand. And could you just talk about that a little bit?
No, look, it's an excellent point. I mean, I think that, you know, Sephora, one of our key priorities right now is being really an inclusive community. And, you know, D&I has always been part of Sephora values from the beginning. But obviously, you know, the murder of George Floyd, the Black Lives Matter movement, really had an impact on us as a company. And I think we really had a chance as a team, as a leadership team, but all the way down to our store teams to talk about this and basically has really strengthened our commitment to be a better company. And we have, obviously, back in 2019, we launched our We Belong to Something Beautiful campaign. That was basically our first attempt at building our efforts in that area. And then in 2020, we really accelerated dramatically. And we're doing that at multiple levels. One of them is, obviously, internally, to ensure that the mix in our leadership reflect the diversity of our employees, our consumers, so both in stores and headquarters. And I have to say, in the last 12 months, we've done some really good progress. Long way to go, but good progress. But it's also, you know, with brand partners. So, you know, as you know, probably we signed the 15% brand pledge. We were first mm-hmm. retailer to do that. And our commitment to help brands that are founded by founders of color, especially people from the Black community. And we actually just, as we speak, you know, in the next couple of weeks, we'll be graduating our first Accelerate class, which is made of 8 founders of, you know, coming back mainly from Black, you know, communities. And it's very, very powerful, because I believe that, you know, retailers like Sephora can make a difference, because if we commit to those brands, then the financial system, the VCs and the private equity guys, they come and start to support those brands. So I think we're starting to see a flywheel here, which is very, very positive. And then, you know, last but not least, we're really trying to reach out. So we have a lot of activities, especially at the store level. We really want store to be a place where everybody feels welcome, independent of your skin tone, your race, your sexual orientation. And this, what we have found, and as you know, we just finished a study that we published about unconscious bias at retail. And we have found that not just in Sephora, but across retail, there is a real issue with racism in stores. A lot of it is unconscious bias, but we as retailers have to make a change. And I feel good about Sephora's price. Now, again, it's a big mountain to climb. So I am very humble about this, but I'm very proud of the way our teams at all levels have embraced that change. And by the way, it makes us a better company internally. It also makes us more successful commercially, because it's such a diverse consumer now in America that if we want to succeed long term, we need to be able to talk to those consumers, and our people, our leadership has to reflect that diversity and that wealth of differences in America. So it's a very exciting time. But in 20, you know, I've been a CEO for, you know, nearly 30 years now. And it's the first time, the first year that I see meaningful change in this area. And this is a powerful moment for everybody in business today.
No, you're so right, Jean-André. And the retail industry is in a unique position as the largest private sector employer in the United States. More than 1 in 4 jobs created, 52 million in this economy, and the first best job for so many of us who started in retail, and a very diverse workforce, and obviously an incredibly diverse customer base. We have a unique voice on these issues, and you're absolutely right. It's a big mountain to climb, but it's encouraging to see the kind of progress already being made. Javi, what do you think? How is the expectation of what consumers want from you change and evolve beyond simply a good product at a great price and convenience? What else do you think customers want today that maybe they didn't want 18 months or 2 years ago?
I think it's building on what Jean-André said. I think it's essential for brands to stand for something else than profits, right? And we've seen through the pandemic, before the pandemic, and I am sure it's here to stay and be even stronger, right?
No, Javi, thank you. That's terrific. Well, Vivek, maybe I'll finish with you. We're almost out of time, but you and I have had many conversations on this topic over the course of the last year. And maybe you could just share some final thoughts with us about how you think consumers will continue to change their attitudes, both about what they want today, but what they're going to want in the future from the retailers with whom they do business.
Matt, I'll just build on what my colleagues said. You know, I think we as retailers, we especially ones, those of us with stores, we operate in communities. We hire from within those communities. We serve people in those communities. We occupy space in those communities. And I think through this pandemic, one of the big lessons we've learned, we've renewed our commitment that we are actually stewards of the communities we operate in. And I think our customers are going to expect us to behave that way, that we actually steward the communities, help when the community needs help, whether it's hunger relief or in our case, doing everything we can to allow people to get vaccinated quickly. It's making sure that the food supply is available and so on and things like that. The second thing I think customers will expect, and I think all generations of customers will expect, is that we too embrace some of the what's important for the society. So the racial tension that we saw in the country last year for us was a huge catalyst that we've got to make a commitment to diversity and equity and inclusion programmatically and not episodically, like I think we have done in the past, right? We certainly have. So in addition to, like you said, faster and being safer and having the right product at the right time and all of those things, I think we as retailers have to add a new dimension of set of responsibilities for the communities that we operate in, and our customers and investors are going to expect it.
Yeah. No, it's those are great thoughts, Vivek. Thank you. For kind of bringing that to a close for us. This could go on another hour. I'd love to keep the conversation going, but I want to thank you, Jean-André, Javi, Vivek. You're such wonderful execs and terrific brands and companies. Thank you for the privilege of representing you, and thanks so much for joining us today for this conversation. Thanks, everyone.